Ladies and gentlemen, the Detroit Civility Project is sponsored by Delta Dental. Please welcome the editorial page editor of the Detroit News and host for 9:10 a.m., Nolan Finley, and host for Detroit Public Television and WDET 101.9 FM, Stephen Henderson.
Hello, everyone. We want to talk to you a little about the relationship that I have with this guy standing next to me, but also something that we're going to ask of you between now and the Mackinac Policy Conference in May. But let's start off just talking about this word, civility, which I think we've all known about for a long time. We hear it all the time. It means different things to different people, though, right? And there are a lot of people who have problems with that word, right? They think it's about silencing criticism. They think it's about shouting down people who are standing up to things like injustice. That's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about something far more intimate. We're talking about the ability on a one-to-one basis to be able to sit across a table or stand across the room from somebody who thinks and sees the world differently than you do, and be able to have a conversation, and to be able to listen to that person, really listen. And sometimes we listen in ways that are about us, right? We listen to somebody thinking about the next thing we're gonna say, as opposed to really listening to that person, really trying to understand what they're saying and where they're coming from. And that's what Nolan and I have worked really hard to be able to do with one another, and what we wanna encourage more of you guys to do as well.
And you know what we're really trying to get at is the polarization of America, the division in America that we all talk about, that we all see around us, and attacking that at its roots. And at its roots are individuals like Steve and I just talking to each other and talking to each other in civil, non-threatening ways. And you know, we did a NPR Story Corps about this about a year or so ago. It's on the Chamber's website, in which we sat out and talked to each other, not about issues, not about politics, not about our differences. We tried to find out how our experiences, how our backgrounds informed our opinion. Our opinions, and we ask a lot of questions about each other, about our experiences in life, from how we grew up. And you know, Steve grew up in the city, rural or urban area. His family very much influenced by the union movement. I come from a rural southern background, from a fiercely independent community where there's not a whole lot of trust in government, and certainly a community that had seen some of the negative outcomes of government policy. And so we talked about those backgrounds and how they inform us as we look at issues, because we both start with the same set of facts, and as all of you do, and we apply our own values, experiences to that, and then come up with opinion. And that doesn't, and it's a different opinion most of the time, but that doesn't make
most
either
of
one of
time,
us evil or you know. And our tendency today is, when we run up against people who don't agree with us, is to say, oh, they hate America, they're ignorant, they're evil people. And it's a lot more complex than that.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody wants the same outcomes. We just think there are different paths to get
there.
Think
about it differently. There is something about being able to look at somebody who you disagree with and really know where the substance of their points of view come from, right? For all of us, life experience is what leads us to believe the things that we believe. And if you can see that in another person the same way you see it in yourself, the same way that you feel so deeply about the things that you believe, if you can recognize that in another human being, it just changes the tenor of the conversation.
Steve and I first became friends, we first basically met each other. We were up on Mackinac Island for a Republican State Party convention, and we're in a bar, imagine that, and where, you know, Steve's over here and I'm over here, and I was talking to a couple of women, and they looked over at Steve and they said, oh, what's he doing here? We hate him. I said, do you know him? And they said, no, we've never met him. I said, well, then how do you know you hate him? Well, he writes this and stuff. I said, why don't you go over there and talk to them? And it's about an hour and a half later, I had to pull him away. And, you know, they had fallen, you know, they'd fallen in love with Steve. How could you not? But, you know, our point was that people aren't their politics.
Yeah.
And, you know, what we are after is for encourage folks to get to know people, something about people other than their politics, before you form an opinion of how you feel about them personally. Because, in general, you know, there's a lot more to people than just
You've
this.
You've got to be able to move beyond what mm-hmm. that ideological framing is that you have for that person. And I'm the first person to say, this is not easy. It is not easy mm-hmm. to do with Nolan.
No,
it is not easy to do with other people with whom I disagree. It has become less easy in the last few years mm-hmm. as the national and the local climate in which we talk about these things has gotten a lot more hostile, right? There is an accelerated effort, I think, to highlight division and highlight the ways in which we can't get along. And so you have to really stick to it. You really have to commit to the idea that you won't judge the person who disagrees with you totally by those views with which you disagree. That you seek to understand who they are, what they think, really what they think, and why they believe it. Why had they come to this conclusion that conflicts with yours? When Nolan and I were talking about StoryCorps, talking in this StoryCorps conversation about our backgrounds, one of the pivotal moments for me was recognizing in his background some of the things that I had in mind, the sort of coming up from poverty, the struggle to succeed and advance in American society, and of course the histories for those things for African Americans, for whites, for people from the South, for people from the North like me are really different. But in each of those stories, I think we found commonality. In mm-hmm. each of those stories, I think we found an overarching agreement about what we want this country to be. We just disagree, and disagree really vehemently, by the way, about how we get there. What are the things that we do?
And there's benefit in that. Being able to talk with someone you disagree with. I mean, his opinions challenge mine, vice versa. We don't go into any conversation thinking we're ever going to convert the other. He is much too hard-headed for that. I gave up on that day one. But I can learn something from him if I am not so convinced in my own righteousness and the smugness of my own opinion
I'll
listen. Well, you know, it's hard not to be. But, you know, if you're willing to listen and not honestly listen, and that's what we're asking folks to do, if you're willing to listen to somebody else's opinion without anger, you can learn something. Yeah. And you can add perhaps you can morph your own opinion a little bit.
I mean, as two people who have spent a lot of their lives making arguments and building arguments and shaping arguments, mm-hmm. I think we could both say that there is no strong argument that hasn't fully considered and accounted for the opposite argument or the spectrum of other arguments out there. And I think both of us have been made better in the work that we do by the relationship we've been able to build, which, you know, is tense at times. Sometimes it is uncivil. You see mm-hmm. it on TV when we get after each other.
Ask Christy.
But at the end of every exchange, there is the idea that it's not the end of the conversation, and that both of us are committed to being able to maintain that dialogue to get to a better place.
Yeah, we're just trying to draw people out. There's a fear today, a reluctance to talk to people who are on the other side of the political divide, and we're trying in this community with the things you're going to hear today and the project we're going to talk about at the end, just trying to bring people across that divide, get to them to the point where they can talk to each other without hate and anger.
Yeah. So. Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome speaker, author, and entrepreneur, Shelby Scarborough.
Hey, how are you? Hello, Detroit. Boy, I got here last night, and I'm so excited to be here. I haven't been here in something like 25 years or more, and it's changed a lot. And congratulations to all of you, because I think you're a big part of that. I was here with Ronald Reagan after he was out of office, and we met with one of the car companies or something like that, and it was a great experience, but this has been even better. All right, the joy of civility. Let me get this going, there we go. All right, so you guys have been sitting here for a little while. You know, one of the first things that you probably did this morning when you came in was you probably shook somebody's hand. You've probably shaken about 400 hands since you've been here. But I'm gonna ask you to do it one more time. But this time, what I'd like you to do is turn to the person to your left and to your right, and instead of saying, hi, how are you, my name is, I'd like you to turn to each other and say, I come in peace. What a concept. Really, it's not that hard. Okay, go ahead. It turns out that that act that we just did is ancient. It is nothing new. It's not new to us, the business people, the modern business person. This is old time stuff, and it meant I come in peace. It really does. So what if instead of coming in and saying, oh, the firm grip, and we're going to, you know, hold that person's hand until it breaks to show them how powerful and how strong we are, how important we are, right? Because we're all very important. I know I am. So instead, if we came in our heads and we said, I come in peace, if we're saying that in our heads every time we have an encounter with somebody, I come in peace, I'm coming to see you, at meet you in the middle of the battlefield and show you that I've got nothing up my sleeve. You've got no reason to worry. Let's have a conversation. Let's start. All right, well, let's fast forward in history quite a bit here to George Washington. So it turns out that George Washington was kind of precocious. At 16 years old, he decided he was bored, he didn't have his Xbox, and he didn't have his iPad or his iPhone, and he decided that he was going to translate French etiquette rules from the 14th century into modern English. Well, for us, the modern English wouldn't sound so good. It would say, one of them was my favorite, is, thou shalt not stand so close to bedew a man with one spittle. Of course, it's old-fashioned English, but it actually is true today. We don't want to be spit in the face when somebody's standing too close to us. But he wrote these, and they've become known as the Rules of Civility, George Washington's Rules of Civility. I was going to say the problem, but maybe we should say the challenge with those is that it's sort of like the old-fashioned schoolmarm aspect of things, and you know, and that's not what I am. That's not what I do. I try to help us connect together as human beings. I don't like the no's and the yeses and the do's and the don'ts and the right and the wrong. I took those rules of civility and I dissected them a little bit more, and I really looked into what they're trying to accomplish by those rules, and I've decided that I want to call them the roles of civility. The roles of civility are much more substantive for this conversation. They're much more about how we relate to people as individuals, how we relate to our society, and our responsibility and our roles in society. Civility is about society. The root is about people and society. It's not about the animal kingdom. It's about people. Although there is civility in the animal kingdom. Whales take 2 minutes between conversations to listen to one another. They give 2 minutes break. Birds give about 50 milliseconds or something like that. I don't think we give people that much time in between to think, to respond. All right, so let's take those, that humility, that dignity, that trust, and that respect, and let's think about it in terms of what our responsibility is. We have to own this. It's not somebody on TV. It's not a politician. It's not your boss. It's not your employee. It's not your parent. It's not your sibling. It's us. It's the only way we can change it. Gandhi said, be the change. I think it's a pretty good three words, pretty simple, be the change. We're going to own this. So how are we going to do that? This cute little kid. When I was my very first job, I said, was with Ronald Reagan. We would walk down the hall to something, and I would say, get to the elevator. And the president would say, I'd say, Mr. President, after you, letting him in the elevator. Because that was sort of my job. I was in presidential advance. was to get him where he was supposed to go and to show him what the logistics of what he was supposed to do so that when he got where he had to go, he could focus on the substance of the conversation. So I'd say, after you, and he'd say, oh, no, after you. And I'd say, no, Mr. President, please, after you. And eventually the Secret Service would go, oh my God, please just get in the elevator, just go. And so we would do this little scuffle, and to this day, I do the elevator and the door dance because I'm so used to opening doors, literally and figuratively, for my fellow man. So what a simple concept, okay? So here's the rules, but here's the rules of civility. Here's a simple act. Hold the door for somebody. Make sure, and there's a whole thing on the internet about awkward stage. I mean, if somebody's way over there, it's a little awkward to stand there and hold the door for 10 minutes. But make sure you see who's behind you. How many people have gotten doors shut in their faces? Happened to me the other day. I was carrying a bunch of boxes and boom, the person in front of me just paid no mind. Of course, I didn't slam them to the floor or say anything because it's about me. It's not about him. I can do better. So after you. And what we need to do, that helps us pull our own weight. We have to own our own experience. Very simple concept, but it shows respect and dignity to the person behind us or before us. Very simple, we can do it every day. But if you think of the larger concept, it's about putting others first, subduing our needs. It's so easy because we're in an I world, a me world. It's so easy for us to say, but I need this. But wait a minute, why don't we look and see about what somebody else might need before we need it? Okay, we're back to George. So it occurred to me that, especially at a business conference, and I'm an entrepreneur, I think about commerce all the time. One of the things that I thought about is, you know, here we have a great queue in our pocket every day. Well, I don't know, it's getting to the point where we don't have many $1 bills in our pockets. But either way, anytime we have a transaction, what if we were to make it into an interaction? Whether you're at Starbucks or picking up your lunch from the lunch line, or in a restaurant, or at the bank, or with your employees. Every interaction, every transaction becomes an interaction. Just make it a relationship, even if it's fleeting. Try to make somebody's day. Give them a smile. What does it hurt? Or there's a wink. I guess George could show us how to wink. So there's the transaction in the interaction. All right, how many people have felt like they were on one side or the other of something like this? I bet all of us have. I know I have. Sometimes I feel like I'm the one going, please stop the noise, don't just stop it, I can't take it anymore. And then on the other side of it, you're seeing this block, this blockade of because somebody does not want to listen to what you have to say. Well, again, we have to take responsibility for that. It's not their fault, it's not our fault, it's not a fault. It's something we just need to own. And there is a better way to do it. I belong to an organization called the Entrepreneurs Organization, and it's been a favorite of mine for 15, 16 years now, because one of the things that we do in that organization is we have a protocol, a gestalt language protocol, a way of talking that is really helpful to take into all of aspects of our lives. And that's basically that we speak from experience. We don't say, in my opinion, or we say, we don't should on you. Anybody heard that? Don't should on me. We don't say what you should do, we say what we know to be true. And I think that can help a lot with credibility. If we bring a mindset of, well, I'm speaking from my experience, that may not be your experience. And what the idea is that we would hear someone's experience and have them share generously of their experience, and in the end, the person that's listening gets to make up their mind on themselves based on their own experiences as to how relevant that situation is to them. It's an interesting way to look at it. And we don't give advice. I think you should do this. We don't give advice. Because especially entrepreneurs, I know, but most people don't like to be told what to do. It's a way for us to make our own minds up and keep our dignity, let the other person have their dignity as well. And we don't have to be the smartest in the room. As our friends before, Nolan and Stephen said, you can listen. We need to learn to listen. Listen to understand, as my sister would say. And this way, we don't put ourselves at the position of some authority. We're all just people. So how many people, you've had somebody come walk into your office or a child walk into your house or turn around and you see this kind of face? you know, it's not very fun to have somebody coming at you with this toxic environment, this sort of anger or something like that. And what we really want to do is take the time to be the change. We want to be the one who helps to rise above and help get out of the noise and be the positive, sunny aspect of that. Sunny side up to be the sunshine in the room. And I'm not talking about being Pollyanna. We don't have to be goofy and Pollyanna about it. We just need to be kind. It's not that hard. But you do have to put yourself behind the line and take a seat back and make sure that somebody in front of you has what they need before you have what you need. I think we can all be our own superheroes in this. We don't need to wait for Superman to come save all of us from incivility around the world. If we do, it'll never come. And we give up our responsibility when we do that. We need to stand up and put our cape on, our big girl cape on, and go out there and show the world what civility is all about. Be the change. So another topic that is really near and dear to my heart, partly because it's my middle name, joy. I believe, and I should say, in my experience, I have found that without joy, it's hard to be civil. And it's like two sides of the same coin. Without civility, it's kind of hard to be joyful. So for me, I use these both in my life, okay? I start to say, okay, what's the best path to connecting with somebody? Is it to create rapport through an informal situation, or is it better to start out more businesslike and get that credibility together and that integrity, that trust? Both ways, it's all important. And these things, when you ignite joy, when you are smiling and when you're happy and when you have that aura about you, you're igniting those things that I call joy juices in your head. And they're the serotonin, the dopamine, the natural occurring drugs that we have right up here that we can ignite. And it helps us get through the day. So if you're feeling bad and you're not feeling very civil because you're kind of grumpy because something happened, which is totally understandable, put a smile on your face, walk out the door, and go buy a cup of coffee for someone else. You know, we have the gift. As human beings, we have a gift that very few animals on this planet have. And that is the gift to communicate with one another at a very sophisticated level. So when we're getting all tangled up in our underwear about who's right and who's wrong and which party is better and who's doing the right thing for the country or not, or all those things that are very relevant discussions, we can give away our generosity of spirit. We can give it away because it amplifies, it magnifies. It's the only thing that comes back to us. It's absolutely free, and it's a simple equation of we give and we get more than we give. So be magnanimous, magnanimity, saying that three times fast. The other part is we have to give ourselves a little bit, just a little bit of a break, because guess what? We're all flawed. Anybody in here perfect? I know I am so not perfect. What I saw something, oh my gosh, it was 25 years ago or more. One of my clients, I had an event with Pope John Paul II. And this, for some reason, this is my trigger to remember this. And maybe it could be yours. But maybe if not yours, pick another one to remember our own humanity. We were doing the opening of a consecration of a children's wing at a children's hospital. And the Pope came in and blessed, consecrated the hospital, and across the way were all these stools, little stools with children who were all cancer patients at the hospital, all in their gowns and having gone through chemo. It was really touching and sad and amazing at the same time. And out of the blue, out of the script, so to speak, the Pope walked over and touched each child on the head. And for me, the whole room just broke up. And for me, it has stuck with me to this day about that literal connection to humanity. That literal, I mean, I have chills now, that lightning bolt that went from his hand through their head and how they were able, I don't know, it didn't change the outcome of their lives probably, but it connected for one moment to show that we're all part of this big world together and we need to love one another. So I like music, so I picked this. This is my civility song, I guess. This is my practice of civility, because that's what we're really talking about. It's a practice, just like a medical practice. You're always learning. It's never a zero-sum game. It's not winner take all. This is a process, and we all can participate at any time we want to. So what we can look at this, these are some of the things I just talked about, to put in order. We can simple greetings, I come in peace, after you, putting people before ourselves and pulling our own weight. We have every interaction is not a transaction. We can keep, make it a relationship, build on that relationship, and find something special about that person that you meet. Simple greetings, here we got the next one. We speak from knowledge, not necessarily opinion. That's a big one. If we can roll our opinions back a little bit and ask more questions than we offer answers, we might get a little further. And we bring the gift of humility and compassion with us wherever we go if we choose to. We can go from victim to victor and be the superhero of our own story. We don't need to be victims in this. We are the solution to this. And patience is our virtue with ourselves and with others. This is a family of man, and we can work together across this stage, across this room, across this city, across the country, and across the world to further the joy of civility. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome President of James Group International, John James, and Chief Executive Officer of James Group International, and the President of Magnolia Automotive Services, and President of TLX, Lauren James, and returning to the stage, Nolan Finley and Stephen Henderson.
I come in peace. So we're going to take you on a little journey here together, because I come in peace. I come in peace. I promise. Have a seat. We're going to take a little bit of time here to talk to these gentlemen about a variety of elements of civility and how that this works into their lives. They're going to share their experiences. And I'd like to turn it to the brothers first. We have two brothers, John and Lauren. And I want to, first of all, I'd like you to introduce yourselves just for a quick second so that we can get a little context on who you are. And then I'm going to ask you a couple of questions.
Sure. I guess I'll lead off because I led off in 1981 and was born before him. So I'm John. I am the oldest of three. Lauren is my my younger brother. I have a younger sister, Carrie. If you're out there listening, love you. I grew up in Detroit with my family, went off to West Point, became a Ranger qualified Apache pilot, and flew 750 hours combat in Operation Iraqi Freedom, 07-09. I had the opportunity to come back to work with my brother and my father at our family business that my father started in 1971 with one truck and a trailer hauling beer. And now I work with my dad and my brother in the automotive industry, and I'll let Lauren get into a little bit about that, but glad to be here.
Thank you.
Great. Lauren James, CEO of James Group International. I've been there for about 12 years now. I went to a similar school as West Point called Arizona State University. decided to play a little bit of football out there and moved back to Detroit in late 2006, early 2007 to work in the auto industry. And we all know what happened in the auto industry between 2007, 8, and 9. So I got a chance to cut my teeth on a pretty interesting industry in a very interesting city. But I always tell people that I wouldn't want to live in any other city but Detroit. You know, Seattle, Chicago, New York, they're all doing fine, just fine without me. But at that time, I thought that Detroit needed not me, but people like me trying to make a positive change. So I think Detroit is a great place to live and work because, you know, if you see a person who's living and working in Detroit, they're here because they want to be. You know, they're here on purpose. And when you're around people who are living on purpose, I think that that's a very good scenario to be in. So, very special place, and I think we only have upwards to go.
Excellent. All right, so there's some, when we think of civility, there's a couple of obvious spots here to have a conversation. First of all, brothers. We all push each other's our buttons, don't we? At some point, you've got to have had a disagreement.
Never, never.
Never.
Ever.
Never disagree. Okay, well, I guess we can.
No, I mean, in the family relationship, there are always disagreements. And you mentioned buttons. I've known this man for 35 years. I know exactly where all of his buttons are. And it goes vice versa.
He's nodding.
And so when you are in a family relationship, and especially when you infuse business into it, it can get very complicated very, very quickly. But and I'll let Lauren expound it from his perspective, but this concept of restraint, just because you can doesn't necessarily mean you should. Getting this close to him and saying, I'm not touching you, in the proverbial business standpoint.
They just grew to about 5
right?
years old, didn't they?
The same thing might happen in business or in our normal relationships with our coworkers or our friends, where you might say something that makes you feel better or you feel or your opinion, and you say, well, this shouldn't hurt you. Why are you feeling hurt? This shouldn't bother you. Why are you being bothered? Understanding that that just because you may be able to manipulate that way, exercising a bit of restraint in that relationship is better for mutual benefit of everyone.
Yeah, John and I are I wouldn't say polar opposites, but we're pretty different.
Polar opposites.
When we're together in the boardroom, I think we play pretty well off of one another, you know, where my strengths are, his weaknesses, and vice versa. You know, I think it's even in how we were educated and where we went, we always have a different perspective on things. You know, he takes copious notes on what he wants to say, and I kind of come out and, you know, tell you who I am and how it is. But that's always just worked. You know, we have the ability to stay in our lane when we need to. I mean, I don't know if there was a single thing in business that we've actually agreed upon, but I think that's what makes us better. At the end of the day, we say, I appreciate your advice, but this is the way that I'm going, and I'm going to support him no matter what happens. I'm a little bit more low-key, I guess. I like to refine what's in front of me. And John, since we were kids, have always kind of, you know, jumped into the pool, you know, head first. You know, he's always done that. And, you know, even to the point to where he came up to me and said, you know, hey, Lauren, I have this idea. I said, what's your idea? I said, I think I'm going to run for U.S. Senate. Excuse me, what do you don't have any name recognition, you're not a political guy, what do you think you're doing?
Way to support him.
You know what, I tell you what, I don't think anyone can deny how great of a job he did and how close he came to actually pulling it off.
Yeah.
And I tell you, he really inspired me, and he's inspired a lot of people to, if you have an idea and you have a will, you know what, there is a possibility that you can do that. So in the grand scheme of things, he has made me a believer in you know, not only I should do things on a small scale, but it's okay to think big every once in a while as long as you have the right support around you. It's been
very
great.
Very good. Very good. So you're in business together as well. So how is there a different dynamic that you employ at work and at home? Are there tricks that you use to kind of keep yourselves?
I mean, I think, you know, we know each other's buttons, and I can just look at him for 2 seconds and know I'm just not going to talk to John for the rest of the morning, and he knows the same for me. You know, John is a very outspoken person. You know, he's I've always said that he and my younger sister are a lot smarter than I am, but he is who he is. He's unapologetically John, and, you know, that's served him very well. But you know, I think when you have a personal relationship with someone for so long, you just know. I mean, everybody in the audience has a sibling or a cousin or a friend where you can just look at them and just tell whether or not they need help with something or you just need to turn the other way and get out of the way. But at the end of the day, if the other person knows that you're there to support them, I think that's important. And what's just as important of that is if I know that he's doing something that's off the rails, I'm going to take him by the collar and pull him this way, and he'd do the same to me.
Very good.
And that's part of the thing, too, is there might be something that I'm doing that seems absolutely crazy, but and sometimes it is. But I was taught in the Army very early on, be very, very careful not to mistake resistance for lack of understanding. A lot of times if we approach people and seek to increase our understanding, as I'm sure Stephen and Nolan have gotten into and will get into, seek to increase our understanding first, then we will see that not only is this thing not a threat to me, but this thing could actually help me. And one of the things that I believe is absolutely crucial to civil society and discourse is trust. One thing that we have, of course, is love, but we also trust that we have the best interest of each other and our families and our communities at heart. And so the first inclination is not to stop the other one or impede the other one. It's generally, how can I add the compliments that I'm able to bring? He talks about me having big ideas, being willing to take risks. But Lauren underplays and downplays his amazing talent to get the most out of the people around him. Lauren is amazing at inspiring and motivating people, building connections, building bridges, and he's able to connect the dots from a very tactical to a strategic level, working from highly defined to very ambiguous situations and circumstances. And I have to tell you, it's something I have a confession to make. I was afraid of the dark growing up. And I think it's something that's innate in a lot of us. And Lauren was always the one who I made go down into the basement first, because if the monster was there, it would get him. But the monster didn't eat him, so he's here, still here. But very much to this day, Lauren is a leader, and he's willing to go forward into the darkness where a lot of people aren't. And this is the type of leadership that we need in this city and in this state right now.
Excellent. It's a beautiful thing, because as I tease you that we push each other's buttons, because we are talking about divergent conversations, divergent points of view. But the beauty here is how you are so supportive of each other as siblings, as business partners, and that it's possible to live in both worlds. Likewise, the two of you, Nolan and Stephen, you talked earlier today, same thing. You have your brothers from another mother, essentially.
And, a really other mother.
And you found a way to find that commonality and support each other at the same time. Especially, you're in the same business, but in competing entities. And so is there a story that you can tell that sort of underscores that?
The relationship between us. Mm-hmm. I have come to think about it in these terms. A lot of times right now, it's really easy to avoid difficult subjects, right? It's easy not to talk about race. It's easy not to talk about poverty or income inequality. It is easy not to talk about politics because you get into it with somebody in a way that is really difficult. But I never, ever have that hesitation with Nolan. It never occurs to me not to bring up something that I know we might disagree about, that might be painful for me, something that I might really be angry about, because I know that I know enough about him, I know enough about who he is and why he thinks the way he does, and I know enough about our relationship to know that we can talk about that, and we could even come almost to blow. I mean, there's been a couple times when, I think we've wanted to punch the other one. But at the end of it, we're better for having talked about it. We're better for having had that dialogue and been able to be honest about it, right? I don't have to cabin my feelings or attenuate the way I think about something when I'm talking to him. I can be who I am. And I think I don't have that many other people that I could sort of count off who sit on his side of the fence that I have that relationship with.
It's when you have that trust and respect.
And I think in truth, we enjoy the friction sometimes, a lot of the times. I mean, a good, healthy debate it's fun. And as we said, it hones your own opinions and your own positions. It's healthy. It's a healthy thing to engage. And, I think we make each other better for that. And we speak to different audiences, but he will surprise me sometimes. And, he's not predictable, as a lot of people would assume. Well, he's a liberal. He's going to always feel this way about everything. It's not true. He's not predictable. I think he's open-minded. And, we've had to defend each other. We've had to defend this friendship to people. Sometimes it offends, right?
A lot.
It offends a lot of people.
Right. Yeah,
and
I get it all the time. How can you possibly be friends with that person?
Yeah, we both hear that. And, we've had to defend each other. And we've had to, explain to people, what we've talked about here. And it always surprises me that someone would think you can't have a close relationship with someone because you hold different political views. You two hold different political views.
Exactly. And,
you know, you know what I'm talking about. It's that's not the basis of your relationship. It's a factor in it, but it provides for some lively discussions.
So let's talk about politics, shall we?
Let's go ahead.
Okay.
Let's go ahead. It's obviously one of the big topics. It's the elephant in the room, so to speak, and mm-hmm. in all rooms across the country at this point, I think. How do we, in your experience, what do you think is one of the best ways that we can kind of get past this divide? Why don't we start with you, John? Since should I save you from last? Do you want to give it some thought?
So I think the start is not in Washington, D.C. They work for us. I think the start is right in our seats right now. I think the start is at our dinner tables. It's at the bar with our friends. Is at the whether it's coffee or going to Hard Luck down the street. It's very important to recognize us for what we are doing to each other, to ourselves. We live in an amazing country, and it really struck me when I went to West Point that no matter what color our skin was, no matter what our gender is, we all were wearing the same uniform. We were all carrying the red, white, and blue. That is what's most important. You don't see a class or a color in our Constitution. We didn't go to combat to fight for a class or a separate race or creed. We went off to defend a country that's awesome because we work together. And I think that the same reasons that we're being torn apart is this political prejudice. Having the audacity to distill someone down to what's on their skin or what's between their legs or the letter by their name, whether it be R or D, is not just doing that person a disservice. It's doing us a disservice. It's doing us a disservice of not giving us the opportunity to truly understand someone else and avail ourselves of the opportunity, as Nolan and Stephen have said, to learn something different, to hone our craft, to be better, and to potentially participate with something that could really change our communities.
I ask myself the question, you know, something that a lot of people have a hard time dealing with. Would you rather be right or whole? You know, and some people would rather be the former. I think you have to get your objective, you know, straight before you even enter a conversation with someone. My objective with a person, whether I'm getting in an argument or a debate, is for them to see where I'm coming from. Not to tell them that I'm right, but for them to see where I'm coming from. And once the other person sees where you're coming from, then that's when the conversation ends. Because at the end of the day, if you start off a conversation saying that someone else is wrong or that whatever you're saying is better, then you've already lost them. What's your objective? Do you really want them to walk away saying, well, the next time I hear people talking about this subject, I'm gonna be equipped with another point of view? Now, if you tick the person off within the first 20 seconds, then I don't care who you are or what you say, they're not gonna take anything away from the conversation. So I have a lot of friends who have different views than I do, but I still hang out with them. But one thing that I always try and do myself is to not be afraid to let them know that I think this way because of this situation. If you can be specific with examples of how things affected you in your life, that's very impactful. You know, I was in a situation with this person and this happened to me. Well, okay, I was in this situation and this happened to me. And the more open you are with another person, and once you kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? Maybe you're vulnerable. Yeah, vulnerability, I think, is very key when you're speaking with someone, because automatically someone can think that, you know, you're trying to win the fight, per se. So I think just being a person, being welcoming, you know, showing peace, like you were just saying, it gives someone a real feeling they can actually talk to you as opposed to fight you.
Yeah, vulnerability builds trust. That's
absolutely
exactly right.
It does. Yeah.
It does, because it opens our hearts up to one another.
Yes.
And we can share more. We can hear more when we do that. Nolan?
Well, just briefly, I don't think our objective is to necessarily close the divide. We don't want everybody thinking the same. We don't expect everybody to think the same. Our goal is to have people be able to communicate across the divide.
That's an excellent thing.
You know, you want to keep the passion. We want people to feel passionate in their beliefs and their opinions. We want to take out the anger.
we talked about that earlier on your radio show today, mm-hmm. that's one of the key things, is that this country is so beautiful because it has these diverse opinions. Right. We have the ability to speak freely. And if we were all in lockstep, that just probably wouldn't be the America that anybody would really want to be in. Yeah.
In addition to not hating the divide itself or thinking that it needs to be cured, I think you have to think about the purpose of civility, right? That it's a vehicle. It's a tool that is really important for us to be able to solve problems. And that doesn't mean come to agreement. That doesn't mean that we drop the parts of ourselves that are different from others. But it does mean using that tool and that vehicle to come to a place that we can say, all right, we can just share this space to get something done, to move forward. You think of all the problems that we have that both sides would say they want to get rid of. We should have a lot fewer problems.
That's right.
The issue is letting that divide rule the day and not using this tool of being able to see the other side for who they are and not as the enemy as a way to get to a solution.
So to cherish our differences and celebrate them, but do it civilly.
Yeah. Yes.
All right, so I think that we're almost done here, but I think you guys have a little announcement you'd like to make.
We do. We talked in the beginning about this project we encourage you all to go through with us between now and the Mackinac Policy Conference at the end of May. We're asking you to go to the Chamber website. It's the DetroitChamber.com/civility and take a look at this Detroit Civility Project. And it's just a little exercise. We want you to do what Steve and I did in that story course session, and that is sit down with somebody from the other side of the aisle and or the divide, whatever you want to call it, but sit down and honestly talk with them about who you are and how you formed your values and your positions, and ask them questions about how they did the same. And Steve, we're just really asking people to listen to one another.
Right. We don't want you to go in there and like talk about politics and talk about the things you don't agree with. We really want you to go and listen to the other person explain where all of it comes from. Why do you think the way you do? Why do you feel the way you do? And why do you believe that your side has the best answers? It's a really wonderful feeling to sit and do that with somebody that you disagree with. And I think if you do it, you'll be surprised at what you are able to think differently about that person. And again, this is not about solving the societal incivility or all of the other arguments we're having. It's about, can you connect with another person who thinks differently from you in a way that leads to meaningful listening and dialogue?
So if you go to the website, sign up, the chamber will match you up. And sometime between now and May, when we go to Mackinac, we're asking you to sit down together and go through this exercise. We're going to tape some of the sessions, and we're going to put together a video and another discussion about this on Mackinac. We'll ask some of you all to participate and tell us what you learned, how it worked for you, with the goal of, what this whole conference is about, the vision for 2030. Our vision is that Detroit becomes the most civil community in the country by 2030. So thank you all.
Thank you. Healthy in many ways, yes? Civil and healthy. Thank you so much, gentlemen. It's been a pleasure. Thank you, Detroit. Wonderful to be here. And I think this could be a model for the rest of the country, so I'm excited to see how it works out.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.